Cataract, hyperopia, and intraocular lens selection and implantation. What visual outcomes you might expect with that combination of diseases? What type of intraocular lenses is better to select in that case? What to do if you have astigmatism? And what you have to discuss deeply with your surgeon before the surgery to get the optimal visual outcomes after the surgery. Hi there! My name is Alexey and you are at IOLadvisor.com channel, telling the truth about intraocular lenses. First of all, guys, let's discuss what is hyperopia and why sometimes you might be not aware that you have the disease before your early 40s. Hyperopia is a refractive disorder of your eye and your vision, which requires you to wear glasses to see sharply at far and all the distances before your eyes. To understand it better, let me show you a few drawings from my patient education website, IOLadviser.com. By the way, links to that website will be in the description below to that video, where you can read about the intraocular lenses, about refractive disorders, about cataract surgery, and what is more important, you can try my automated IOL questionnaire, which will guide you through the IOL selection process, because all the lenses are different, and visual outcomes with different IOLs are absolutely different, and the intraocular lens selection process is a quite complicated process, which has to consider your visual needs, your previous visual experience, and your medical conditions. That's why it's quite difficult to discuss all the details with your doctor, and I encourage you to try this questionnaire, bring the results together with you to your doctor, and discuss your expected visual outcomes depending on your visual needs and expectations which you put inside of that questionnaire. And if you are still in doubt about IOL type or IOL model and you need more information which you are not able to get from your surgeon, I'm here to help. I'm offering you my personalized intraocular lens selection consultation, which will help you to understand better the lenses, technologies, visual outcomes, and what to discuss with your doctor to get the final decision on the intraocular lens implantation. All the details are available at my website, IOLadvisor.com. Coming back to hyperopia. First of all, we have to understand that our eye is a combination of two lenses, the cornea and the crystalline lens. And the idea of this lens is to focus all incoming light rays directly to the retina. The status of the eye when the optical power of cornea and lens perfectly aligned with the so-called axial length of the eye, so total length of the eyeball, called ametropia. It means that eye refraction is perfectly aligned to the eyeball sides. And in case of hyperopia, in vast majority of cases, the eyeball size is smaller than normal. What does it mean? It means that incoming to the eye light rays, which are passing through the cornea and the lens, are focused visually behind the retina. It means that the vision of the patient without eyeglasses or contact lenses is blurry at any distances from the eye. If we compare low to mild hyperopia patients with a low to mild myopia patient has some advantages because low to mild myopia allows patients to see clearly at near distance without glasses, and sometimes myopia called nearsightedness, which means that people see clearly at near without glasses. And it is not the case for hyperopia. Despite the hyperopia, sometimes called farsightedness, patients with a hyperopia don't see clearly at any distances, either far or near. Here is an important point to note, that in order to compensate this refractive disorder of the eye, we have to put a so-called plus lens in front of the eye to compensate this refractive disorder, to add the optical power to the eye, and we move the focal point behind the retina exactly to the retina. And interestingly, that we have number of people born with a low to, let's say, mild hyperopia in the range of about plus one, plus two, maybe plus three. And as we have accommodation mechanism and accommodating our eye, increasing the optical power of the crystalline lens, in majority of cases, this low hyperopic patients are not aware about their hyperopia because they are able to compensate their far vision problems by accommodation. And it means that in the childhood or maybe till the early 30s, these patients are totally free of glasses and doesn't have any problem with their vision. And when the presbyopia age came, which is the case for normal people after the age of 40 and in many cases up to 45, with a mild to low hyperopia patients, these symptoms of visual acuity degradation appears way earlier because we lose ability to accommodate. And that's why for low hyperopic patients, we lose ability to compensate this imperfection of the eye to the far and respectively at near. That's why that type of patients experience bad vision at near earlier than normal population, and what is more important, that patients start to experience far vision problem as well because they are not able to accommodate anymore. Hyperopic patients at the age of 40 plus needs an eyeglasses or contact lenses to compensate and to correct the far vision, and they need a reading glasses. Other words, they need either progressive glasses, or they need two pairs of glasses for far and near, sometimes for intermediate, or they have to use a contact lenses or progressive contact lenses or multifocal contact lenses to be spectacle free. And if it is not the case for you and you don't want to use any glasses or contact lenses, you might be thinking about the refractive lens exchange, as a procedure which will replace your natural crystalline lens with an intraocular lens or IOL, which will compensate your farsightedness or your hyperopia, and with a so-called presbyopia correcting lens type, will allow you to see clearly without glasses, because that type of lenses, I am talking about so-called premium or presbyopia correcting intraocular lenses, will compensate a lack of accommodation due to so-called pseudo-accommodation. So all the details about the type of lenses available on my channel and on my website IOLadvisor.com. So I will not dig deeper into the different lenses, and now I will explain you what happens with a cataract for that patients. And moreover, I will explain what is the specific of refractive lens exchange patients which want to exchange the lens to see clearly without glasses, because intraocular lens selection in that case is similar, and the approach is similar as well. As you might know from my previous videos, that intraocular lenses shall be calculated precisely for every particular case, for every particular patient, and every particular eyeball size. And as you may know from my website and from my previous videos, we are not able to calculate the intraocular lenses precisely exactly to every particular eye. Moreover, even light adjustable lens is not able to provide you with a diamond sharp precision after this cataract surgery, even with adjusted refraction, because we are adjusting the lens, but the eyeball is a living tissue, etc. So if you look in the FDA data of light adjustable lens, of course they have a better precision, but it's not exactly the, let's say, 100% sure. I'm not talking that light adjustable lens is a bad solution. Moreover, I'm not talking that standard lenses or premium lenses are ideal solution or bad solution. I just want to emphasize that intraocular lens calculation and residual refraction after any type of surgery with any type of intraocular lens might be slightly different from exactly so-called plano emmetropia or ideal solution. It is a reality of our industry. Despite that fact, we have extremely high satisfaction rate and we have extremely high success rate of our visual outcomes after the surgery. And to understand how to achieve it, let's move further and to understand what happens with a highly hyperopic patients. So we have two basic problems of hyperopic patients. And both of these problems are related to the fact that the eyeball is smaller than normal. It is way more difficult to calculate ideal intraocular lens power simply because of mathematics included into the formulas. Now we have more complicated formulas, even artificial intelligence powered formulas, etc. But still, we have more risks to calculate the lens properly, or more risks, let's say, to have to calculate the lens in a bit wrong way. It is the nature of hyperopic patients. The second problem, when we implant the lens, we into the any type of lens, either myopic, hyperopic, normal, emmetropic, the lens is placed inside of the capsular bag, and lens might shift slightly versus retina. So the distance between the focal plane of the lens and the retina might be shifted slightly. Shifting of the lens position inside the capsular bag results in changes in distance between the lens focal plane and the retina. And what does it mean? It means that in highly hyperopic patients with a smaller eyeball size, these changes in the distance will give higher effect on visual acuity after the surgery. So it is more complicated to calculate optical power of the lens. Plus, the lens is more sensitive to shift of the position. It means that for highly hyperopic patients with any intraocular lens type, residual visual outcomes and visual acuity might be at a higher risk than for normal patients. But we have a good news for that patient as well, especially if we're talking about the enhanced monofocal intraocular lenses or true extended depth of focus intraocular lenses. We have a number of clinical observations, and it might be somehow explained by the nature of high hyperopia and especially of the by the nature of EDOF lenses, that for that type of patients, depth of focus with an enhanced monofocal lenses or extended range of vision, extended depth of focus intraocular lenses might be better compared to myopic or even ametropic patients. Why it is happening? My personal understanding is that we have a given amount of sharp vision, amount of depth of focus for given intraocular lens. And then if we put that fixed amount of, let's say, sharp vision to the shorter eye, we have better coverage of the entire range in front of your eye. And vice versa, if you're talking about the longer myopic eye, we have a lower coverage of that focus comparing to total eyeball size. I might be wrong with the explanation of that phenomena, but if you Google this phenomena or you discuss with your doctor, most probably you will have a confirmation of the data. Well, I hope for now it is clear, but if something isn't clear yet, please don't hesitate to ask me any comments below and I will try to respond to the best of my knowledge. Let's talk a little bit about the intraocular lens type selection for that particular type of patient. Theoretically, understanding the complication of intraocular lens power calculation and bigger depths of field, I think that extended range of vision lenses like EDOF or even enhanced monofocal might be a good solution. However, it's important to understand that every patient is different and any patient's visual needs are absolutely different. So the best way is first of all to discuss with your doctor your particular visual needs, your visual expectations and your visual experience before the surgery and after the surgery, what you might expect and what you would like to have after the surgery. And as I mentioned already earlier, it's a good idea to run through the IOL questionnaire, print it out and bring the results to your doctor, because you can discuss together with your doctor the questions, your response to the question and what does it mean for particular intraocular lens available at particular location. And what is important to keep in mind if you are talking about enhanced monofocal or extended depth of field intraocular lenses for hyperopic patients. As I mentioned, these lenses might give you a better depth of field. It's important. Then it's important to remember that precise calculation of any intraocular lens is way complicated for hyperopic patient. And what does it mean? It means that you will be lucky enough to get the precise IOL calculation and placement. You will have optimal visual outcomes according to the lens type and lens model you have selected. The next case scenario, if you will have so-called myopic shift, so that your eye will be slightly myopic after the surgery. For that type of lenses, it means that you will have even better near vision acuity, but your far vision will be slightly compromised. And the worst case scenario for that type of patients, if your intraocular lens will be calculated slightly to hyperopia, you will have slightly hyperopic shift. It means that you will still have a good far vision, but your near vision will be worse than you might expect. Why is this happening? Because enhanced monofocal and extended depth of field intraocular lenses have a relatively flat defocus curve, which can compensate for refractive shifts to the hyperopia, but it is not able to keep your near vision at a good shape. If you are the first time on my channel, probably you don't know what is defocus curve. Please have a look to that corner and to the description below to this video. I will put a link explaining what is the focus curve, how it affects vision after the cataract, and how the focus curve and use of glasses related in your visual outcomes. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel right now, give me a thumbs up, and see you next video.